is the A in advance. Assemble structure and add style. Now, as I might have mentioned earlier on, there's been kind of a backlash over the last 15, 20 years in the teaching writing industry to abandon structure, don't teach style, just let people kind of write as they wish, and whatever comes out will be great. Well, it's just not working. And so we want to have you look at the essay writing process as similar to almost anything that would have structure. As I'm doing this today, we're about a month or so away from Christmas, and I'm just thinking of a Christmas tree right now. That's definitely something that has both structure and style. The tree itself, the shape of it, gives the structure on which we can add things like decorations and ornaments that add style. And the combination of the two of those working together make something very beautiful, something that is attractive, something that we're interested in. If you just had a tree with no decoration, that would be kind of boring. If you just had a box full of ornaments without careful placement around the tree, they just look like a pile of junk. But you put the two together and they really start to become something very significant, something very meaningful. And so that's what this A is about when it comes to assemble the structure, add style. And so first there's several structures that we want to look at, and then we're going to add in some stylistic techniques. The basic structure that is the most foundational, of course, is one that we've already talked about in the research part of this process, and that has to do with what we called the topic clincher rule. And if you remember what the topic clincher rule was for a basic paragraph, it was the topic sentence and the clincher sentence must repeat or reflect 2 to 3 key words. And we actually had some hand symbols that we teach the kids in our classes, the students in our classes, to help them remember that rule. Now, the paragraph is really the basic building block of your entire essay. And so if you can master the paragraph and put enough of these building blocks together, then you will have a substantive essay that will be easy to read, that a marker will delight in to receive and make their job much, much easier. And I don't know if you mentioned this before, but one of the main jobs you have as a essay writer is to make your marker's job easier. If it wasn't for the marker, you wouldn't likely be doing this. So we want to remember that the topic sentence and the clincher sentence must repeat or reflect 2 to 3 key words. Then what we want to remember is that we have to have some facts in there, some facts that are related to the topic. We always want to be thinking topics whenever we're doing research, whenever we're reading what topic is this, and then we're also wanting to think facts and details. We've shown that at the elementary levels, you might want to have maybe 3 to 5 facts or details in an essay, a short essay by a young student. As you get more advanced, you're probably wanting 5 to 7 details per paragraph. Any more than that, and you're probably wanting to move on to a more advanced paragraph. Now, when we talk about structure, we want to make sure that we understand that really the essay structure is really just a collection of paragraphs put together in a certain manner. And what we have here is a structural model for an essay. And this is typically what's called the 5-paragraph essay. Now, you'll see this in all kinds of other types of teaching on essays. Some people disdain the 5-paragraph essay. They just think, oh, you know, why can't you just write whatever you want? Some people only subscribe to the 5-paragraph essay as the starting point. But whether you do or you don't, it still works. And basically what we're looking at here is a 5-paragraph model. Now, later on in the book, we will talk about extended essays, super essays, argumentative essays, a variety of types of essays. But again, we're looking at the basic essay, the basic building block of future essays and how they are laid out. So in the basic essay, the basic 5-paragraph essay, we basically always have an introduction. That makes sense. And a conclusion. That also makes sense. Now, what we have here on this particular slide is that we're going to cover those in much more detail when we get to the C, the letter C in the advanced formula. That letter C actually stands for conclusions and introductions. And that deserves a whole section unto itself, and you'll discover why when you get there, how important your introductions and conclusions are. Without those, you're basically dead in the water. But you also have to have body paragraphs to support the thesis that you are providing in the introduction and to support the conclusion that you come up with in the conclusion, or your final statement of the thesis, which often is your conclusion. In between, you'll have something called body paragraphs, and again, each one of these is related to an individual topic. So if you had three topics, you'd have three paragraphs in the middle, three topics. And then we follow the topic clincher rule. We have the 5 to 7 details, and this is the building block of a basic essay. Some people have put it this way. In the introduction, you're going to tell them, and this is kind of crass, but you're going to tell them what you're going to tell them. Then in the body, you're going to tell them. You're going to tell them what it is that you want to tell them. Tell them what you're going to tell them. And in the conclusion, somebody once said, you're going to tell them what you told them. So the introduction tells them what you're going to tell them, then you tell them, and then in the conclusion you tell them what you told them. And it's great. It's a great structure, but it's not something new. And we have an immense thirst in the academic community, teacher training colleges, schools. They have an insatiable thirst for things that are new. And if we created something called new, they would just run to it like lemmings. The problem with new is that 5 years later, now they're running to something else that's new, and that cycle gets repeated several times, and pretty soon you don't even remember what was new 5 years ago. All you do is just want to chase something new. This, on the other hand, is not something new. I can't take credit for it. I didn't invent this. I'm just passing it on to you. In fact, this particular model was called the Aristotelian model for rhetoric. And it was created by a guy by the name of Aristotle something over 2,000 years ago, a great Greek philosopher, trainer of Plato and Socrates. Socrates actually trained Aristotle, who trained Plato. I believe that's the way it was. They're very closely related. But they really formed the foundation for Western thought, and the way we think very much today comes from Greek civilization, from Greek thinking, philosophers of that time. Aristotle kind of believed this about people: they're basically stupid. Now, I hate to put it that way, but he said, you know, you're going to have to tell people at least three times before they're going to believe you or understand you. At least three times. Dr. Webster has a saying. He says, you have to repeat something 55 times for lifetime learning. If you're going to remember something for the rest of your life, you really have to repeat it about 55 times. So somewhere between Aristotle and Webster, whether it's 3 or 55, you do have to tell people repeatedly something if you want to affect their behavior. And so Aristotle thought that you needed to have at least 3 times. And so this was called the Aristotelian model for rhetoric. We'll be right back.